coming. We already had the one first talk for Professor Pilar Kaung. She's coming from Moscow, from the last country. The second talk is more related to electronics. It's called Design Cycle of Mass Electronic Products. And I'll just pass her to so that she can do the presentation.
Good afternoon, thank you for coming. This talk is Design Cycle of Mass Electronic Products. And this thing over here is very important because this is based on the processes of microelectronic systems that was where I work. So all the material belongs to them, and all the material is publicly available. Okay, there is nothing that I took from my job. This is public information they have as advertising in the web page. Okay, so first I'm going to introduce myself. I come from the University of the Basque Country. The Basque Country is in the Atlantic axis. Okay, it's there in between the Spanish state and the French state. We are very close to the border. We have three territories, which is Vizcaya, Guipúzcoa, and Araba. Our university, we have three campuses, one in each territory, although maybe there are some faculties somewhere else. We have 45,000 students, 4,400 lectures registered, and 1,800 administration staff. There is some information about the Basque Country there. There are 7,200 square kilometers, and 2,200,000 inhabitants. Okay. And they were asking about this information that there is 42% of bilingual people, because in the Basque Country, both Spanish and in the Spanish state, both Spanish and Basque are official languages. Okay, so students, they have the right to choose which language they want to study in. Okay, in the Basque Country, students choose the language. For example, in Catalonia, teachers do choose the language. Okay, those numbers there are the different faculties of engineering that are in cities. In red, they are the ones from the University of the Basque Country. And in black, they are faculties from other universities, mostly private universities. So in Vizcaya, there are two faculties from the University of the Basque Country and one private. In Guipúzcoa, we are three faculties that are public and three private. This is only in engineering. Okay? In Araba there is one faculty, and there that is outside the map because they are in the French part of the Basque Country. There is one faculty in the French part, and one public university but from Navarra. That is, these ones, they are more or less between the three points, 1 hour away by bus. So this is to show that we have a lot of engineers studying in the faculties. We all have jobs. It's not like we have few students. We all are full of students, and this is because of the Basque industry. Because historically, Basque industry has been very strong. If you take a close look to the map, you can see that most of the faculties are close to the sea, because there is a sea there in the top. That's because that's where the harbors were, and where they would somehow merchandise the things that were manufactured there. And also, there were iron mines in the Basque Country, so they have to manufacture and to transport somewhere close to the mines. Okay. So here is the Basque economy, and this is this number, I don't know how to read very well. So we have over 300,000 professionals from all fields of knowledge that have already graduated from our university. We have 70 degrees in different fields, 65 PhD programs, and 120 masters. Okay. And I'm coming from the Faculty of Computer Science, that the first origins were in 1971, where computer science still didn't have a name and they were trying different things. And it was one of the three first faculties in the Spanish state to offer computer science studies in 1976. Okay, so it's one of the oldest ones. Nowadays we have two bachelor degrees, one in computer science and the other one in artificial intelligence that is new, it's going to start this year. And three master degrees in embedded systems engineering, in computational engineering and intelligence systems, and in language analysis and processing. Okay, so here's my experience before I just changed 3 years ago, more or less, no? To the Faculty of Computer Science. I was working also in the Faculty of Engineering of Gipuzkoa, which is, I would say, is crossing the road in San Sebastian, because we are all very close. I was there 6.5 years. And prior to that, I was 4 years in ICOR Electronic Systems. That's why I say that all the information from HIROM is public information, but it's their manufacturing process. Okay. Anyway, it's a common manufacturing process for other companies, so it's very general. Prior to that, I was 5 years in the research center doing the PhD. Okay. If we want to do a new product, we have to develop the original idea, and before that can go to mass production, we have to do some steps. Okay, because if you are working in an engineering company where you only develop the product, you are not going to take into account all the stages you need in order to do mass production. In this company, ICOR, they leave the customer to choose whether they want to do part of the engineering and they take from that point to mass production, or they can also do the developing of all the project with the design and all the passes. Okay, so there is a need for a product life cycle management because there is not only a function that the product has to meet. It has also to be optimized for mass production. Okay, so here is the design cycle. It's going to be in all the slides. In the design cycle, we see here that there are some stages. Usually the product definition and the product design is here. That is usually the place. I was working here mostly with the engineers. I was not working in this part, but we were showing the facilities and the process to partners and stuff like that. So if you're working in an engineering company, you're probably going to stay here only with the design of the product. But we can see here that it's a production ramp up when there is more work for production and then there is less work for production. Okay. We're going to see this process. If we take a look at the product development project management, we can see somehow in engineering should be the opposite way. Okay, we have more engineering, sort of you are starting with the project, then we have product definition, specification, design, then we do verification in each stage, in implementation, the project has gone into implementation, there is not that developing engineering a lot, and then goes up again. So this one is the contrary of this one. So that we have more work in production, there is less work in engineering. And if we have less work in production, there is more work in engineering. Okay, so we're going to see the first stage, that is the new product. The new product is we get to the validation stage, that is the validation of the product. Okay, so then we are going to have also the validation for the manufacturing process. Okay, because in this type of companies, they are not only development engineers. They are also process engineers and product engineers. Okay. Usually in faculties of engineering, they're teaching only say usually, because I don't know why people here, but they're teaching only development engineering somehow. And when they go into this type of companies, they have to learn that process engineering and that product engineering. Okay, so here, in the first stage, this is the first part, it's product definition or product design. Everyone knows what's about. And then we have some stages that has to be taken into account if this product is going to be to mass production. Okay. That's where process engineers come in. And we have, for example, the DFMA analysis, that is the design for manufacturing sample. Okay. Here they take into account some indicators, for example, the failure mode and effects analysis, that is the FMEA. They also have to define how the implementation is going to be. Okay, so they have to take into account the product reliability. So these all are indicators they have. They know how to manage them. Don't know because I never worked with them. But they have, for example, the predicted production defect rate, things like that. So when they're producing, they have to meet that these requirements are fulfilled. Okay. They have to meet these requirements so they are cost effective and also quality effective. Okay. They also have to take into account that they have to do a validation not only on the product, because when we think validation, we always think on the product. You don't know anything about process engineering. It has to be a plan definition for product validation. Okay, so this is the validation of the process. Okay, so it has to, they have to define there how they are going to do the product validation. There is also depending of the roles of and different countries, they have environmental testing, electromagnetic compatibility diagnosis, ethical safety, that depends on the country, which is very important because the competition can also test those things. Some product doesn't meet those requirements, they can report to the government, for example, that they are not meeting some of the requirements. After they are doing the mass production, the last step is the definition of the product maintenance. That is how they are going to handle, for example, components that are not working properly and have to change. So maybe they have to keep some components because they may disappear or they may become obsolete and they won't be able to repair them. Then in industrial product development, then we have seen that we have to implement and validate a production process. Okay, a production process for mass producing the product. That has to fulfill some requirements. Okay, so this is very important for the quality of the product and for integrating this product design that we have said that they can choose to do in the company that decides to make a product and the production processes. So that NPI over there is new product introduction. Here we can see that we have test optimization and the mass production. Okay, test optimization. Sorry, that is because depending on the product, it's going to be very costly to check all the parts of the product. So the client has to decide whether they want to check everything or they want to change some of the devices that are manufacturing. Okay, here are some stages in there. The first one, of course, is the project planning. The project management is required to define the product quality planning. Okay, because this planning stage, they have to set some specifications. Okay, we can check everything, we can check all the products, but if we check all the products, we are going to have a lot of time, it's going to be out of cost because we are going to have we are going to spend a lot of hours checking the products, and if we spend less time you may have an impact in quality. The second one, introducing a new product, is the product definition. These ones depend on the specification of customers, okay, and the requirements of the sector, because we have said that we may have some requirements, for example, for electromagnetic compatibility. So these requirements, they comprise product structure definition. Then there is also this part that is going apart from development engineering, that is selection of materials and suppliers. Suppliers, when manufacturing in mass production, is very important, because if you are lacking a component, it can delay on the process. Okay, so it's very important to have suppliers you can rely on. They also have to be alternative design proposals to optimize the quality and cost. Okay, so this is for example when the design was done by the engineering company and they take to the manufacturing company. Maybe some changes to design have to be done, because there is such a thing that is called design for manufacturability. So sometimes something that works for a design and a prototype doesn't work for mass production. The third stage is the definition of the manufacturing process. The process is defined with the aim of optimizing cost and ensuring product quality. Okay, and here again, they have some methodologies they applied that are related to the manufacturing process. For example, the manufacture modes and effect analysis. It has also to be a raw material control plan, a production process control plan. Also, a control for the documentation and capacity studies, because if you have a manufacturing line, you are going to have a capacity for a number of PCBs per hour, for example. Depends on your equipment. The fourth stage is the definition and validation of test and verification systems, because we have said that if we want to ensure quality, we have to do some tests and verification. And these testing systems are combined with product traceability to record the results, and to see whether maybe there was a problem with a batch. You can know where are the PCBs with that component that has some kind of trouble. Okay. The most common testing systems are ICT, that stands for in-circuit test. In-circuit test is a flying proof. It means that you are testing, you can test at least all the components of the circuit by means of electrical function. Sort of, we don't care about the functional test, but we care about, we have here five volts. Here we have had maybe 5 volts or maybe 0 volts, it's an electrical test. And then FSCT, sorry, is a function test, it can be GTAC, boundary scan, and here you check the functionality of the component. And you can choose to check all the components or all part of the product you are manufacturing. Then there is a stage that is called pre-series. Pre-series means that everything is prepared for mass manufacturing, but you cannot launch a mass manufacturing without knowing if there is something wrong. Because if someone, for example, did put, for example, a diode the other way, you're going to have a lot of problems to desolder the diode, to change all the layouts, and to put it into mass manufacturing. So a pre-series is a small series where we can ensure that all means of productions and processes are set up properly, okay, and that everything is standardized and is repetitive, and we are not having some kind of errors or something in the process is wrong. The sixth stage is the process validation and means of production. The manufacturing process is evaluated and monitored to ensure its optimization and to obtain the intended quality results. So the production process has to be approved. It's only approved when quality objectives are achieved. Okay. And till now is the new product introduction. The next one is the supply chain services. The supply chain services covers, you can see here, both the new product integration, introduction, and the mass production. Okay. This is because the supply chain services, it has to be planned before you go into mass production. Okay, because when you go into mass production, you already have to have all the components, and you have to be sure that there is no one missing, or there isn't any problem with any component, or you're going to have problems with a supplier or things like that. Okay, so they have to do a forecast of what they're going to need. It depends on the product delivery period. They want to deliver the product in a certain amount of time. They cannot have a component that is going to arrive later, okay? Or the supplier level of service, this is saying different suppliers, they have different levels of services, meaning they are going to give the product faster, or they have sometimes available some stock of the product, or they have to manufacture it, okay? So it has to be done a good forecast to optimize the inventory and to minimize obsolete materials, because we have said that in the after sales service depends on how long is going to be the product in the market. You probably will have to keep some components if you want to repair parts of that product that you're working properly. So that's why it's very important to have a supplier evaluation and qualification system, because they can assure the quality of these suppliers. Okay. For example, in this company, I don't know if you remember, I don't know if this happened here. You know, in these Chinese shops that they were selling USBs that were empathy. Did it happen here in Portugal? In Chinese shops, these convenience stores, they were selling something that looked like a USB, a pen drive, but instead was empathy. And they were selling by 2 euros, it was very cheap. And people was buying it, and it was empathy. For people, for normal people. But for example, here in this company, it happened the same ones. They did buy one component, they demonted it because they were trusting the supplier, and it was not working, and they didn't know what happened. And they were testing everything, and it was not working. And then someone decided to put this PCB inside the X-ray machine, and they discovered that one of the components was empathy. That way, it's very important whenever you're going to use, or when you want to hire a company with for product production, that they have a supplier quality assurance, okay? Because something like that may happen, that you are buying a component that maybe is empathy, or it's not with the fashion, or it's not working well. Then the next one is the mass production. In the mass production, we see there are a lot of stages here. In mass production, there can be a small and large series, depending on whether it's going to be sort of a small batch or a large batch of the product. Usually, if the batch is larger, the development of the process is going to be more or less the same for both, so it's going to be cheaper for each product. here in mass production, there are also some standards that have to be complied. Okay, there are standards for electronic assemblies, there are standards for electrostatic discharge, how to handle parts, electronic parts. Here we see sipping and use of moisture. That is also very important because these components we are going to see later are going to be put into an oven. So the plastic encapsulate, it absorbs the moisture. So what happens is if they have moisture inside and you put it into the oven, there's something that they call the popcorn effect. Okay, it's like the components explode like popcorn. So that's why it's very important to have to handle this moisture. So the first stage is the section of the, and there, that's why I say an inspection of materials, because they have to check if there is any problem with the components. So it has to be a control authentic batch with traceability and FIFO system. In this company, they have an automatic warehouses where they have a controlled humidity and temperature, so there is not any problem with the components. They have low humidity rules and vacuum packing of components, so they don't get humidity. The second stage of mass production is SMT. I don't know if somewhere there in the presentation is SMT. SMT is surface mounted technology, and SMD is surface mounted device. Okay, it's the technology and the device. Here are the parts of the of an assembly line. It's also is sort of a standard for manufacturing facilities. The first one is called serigraphy. In serigraphy, you have the PCB, and you put a soldering past over the PCB. There is a stencil, and there is sort of a brass that puts the past over the PCB, only where the components are going to be. Okay, here is a picture of the assembly line. Again, this is public, okay, anything. This is the serigraphy machine. So you put the PCB inside, and there is a stencil according to your product. There is a brass, and you put a very thin thin layer of soldering past. There are different mixes of soldering pastes depending on what you are going working with. So they try them, some of them work, some of them don't work. It's the same. They also have traceability because they are, it's like a fresh something, so they expire. So this is what, say, what it says there is depositing solder past at soldering points. Is nowadays they have 100% accuracy. Means they have the vision 2D, and with that they assure that everywhere where a component has to be, they're solving faster than them. Then the second one, that is this one over here, this is a pick and place machine. A pick and place machine, we can see here that we have some pieces where we have the rolled. I don't know how to call that in English. The components are rolled in sort of paper, so you can roll out the components with the paper. I don't know if you have anything here.
Like a coil or a
yeah, it's like a coil with the components there, usually in plastic or in paper. So this is the pick and place machines. These are for VGA, that is ball grid array. CSP, that is chip scale package, is also surface mounted. And POP is a package on package, meaning you can put one circuit and on top another circuit. That's what is called package on package. You say if you have two circuits that are going to be connected one with the other one, you can save out of space in the PCB, you put one over the other one. That's called package on package. So this machine, for example, it has a certain velocity. So it takes the components from this coil, and it's a robotic arm. Well, there are some robotic arms inside that are taking the components and placing them in the PCBs very quick. And then there is an oven. It's the oven. These things in the middle, they are to handle the PCBs. Because when you are working with them, you have to put them somewhere. So these pieces in the middle have to handle the PCBs. And that device over there, that's the oven. So they have also a process to control the temperature of, inside the oven. They have different temperatures inside the oven. So you have a preheating, a heating, and then a post-heating. So you control with the temperature of the components. After that, there is the AOI, that is the automatic optic inspection. This was the oven, so here is the AOI. This is a camera that checks that the components in the PCB match a reference, sort of that was done with the prototype. And the last one is the, if necessary, is the X-ray inspection for parts with hydrogen solder. Those components that have the bulk breath array under the component, they need to be inspected under X-ray, because you cannot see if all the bolts were places correctly, or there is one missing, something like that. And again, these things over here in the end, these ones are to handle the PCBs. There is another stage here that the previous one was surface mounted. This one is commonly called through hole. But a through hole means the name inside that the component passed from one part of the PCB to the other part of the PCB. Usually this one has to be done by hand, because with robotic arms. Nowadays there is still a problem with putting something through a hole, because if you touch a little bit of the surface, there you get mechanical forces, and it's very difficult to control, because you have to control the dynamics and the cinematics of the robot. So usually this is done by hand. So it's most costly, because you have to have people putting them in hand. Then these ones are also, they go through a soldering process that it also has a thermal profile control. I don't know if I say this one, but here the oven is to solder the components, okay, because you have the past, and you put the component over it in the pick and place machine, and then in the oven it gets stick because of the past. Here in PTA, usually has to be done with selective soldering. Selective soldering can be done with a robotic arm that goes to the place where you can see, and that's a secret soldering there. Also, if there are a lot of them, it also can be done by something that is called the soldering wave. Okay, they have a machine with a machine that puts a wave under the PCB, and so it can get this stuff. And this also has the automatic optical inspection. Here's one worker that is putting the components in the PCB. It has to be done by hand, and you realize they have a cloth, and the cloth is special for handling electronic components. Then there are the systems, ICT, FCT, the circuit test and the functional test. The circuit test, we have said that it's a proof, it's a point that is moving. That's why it's called flying proof, because it moves very quickly. The functional test can be done with several technologies depending on the manufacturer. Here, there are some places for workers depending on what project they are working in, they can do different kinds of things in those places. Usually it's one worker per place, and they can do some of the checks, because you have to put those ones by hand in the machine to do the test and take away and do the test. So this is very costly, because it has to be done by hand. So usually they decide if they want to do to all the production or only to certain products. Then along all the stages, they have a product traceability. They use a data matrix to the traceability. So if something happens, for example, with the component we have said, they have to look for all the PCBs with that component and correct it. Then there is another stage that is called automatic circuit with the paneling. The paneling means that the PCBs are usually, they come together. Like this, I don't know how you call this one. These sticks for children that come with some points, it's sort of that. They come together, so the paneling means that you have to cut them and break it. Okay, so this is the paneling. It has to be done with a high precision machine, because otherwise, if it happens to say that it's a stick of children, you can break it. So they have a high precision automatic paneling line, and then they have the precision that is very small, plus minus 0.002 millimeters, and that's the characteristic. And after they already have each PCB in an independent way, they do a circuit wash cycle. Okay, they wash the circuit, because they can be ionic collection. They wash with, they have actually some drugs to wash the PCBs. They do clean, rinse, and dry. Okay. And the last one is the coating. Coating, because we can have different environmental conditions. So coating means that they are applying and curing. It can be depending on the environment. It can be silicone, polyurethane, varnishes. Sometimes where they are doing small batches or they are doing series, they do by hand. And they have a brush, and they paint the PCB with these things. You can smell the, sometimes you can smell the parties. So it's protected from the environment. And if they need to be put inside somewhere, this is the box building. The box building is also, it's also important, because it has to be perfect electronic copy. You can have, for example, the box and the book to somewhere else, and things like that. And there is a stage that is called burning and life test. They call burning chambers or burning rooms, where they have usually very high temperature. They take part of the production, and they start using the product. For example, if it's a washing machine, they start to use it all the time, the washing machine. Turning around to see when something fails, what fails, something is happening. So they can do what is called accelerated life test, because there is very high temperature and it's working all the time. They can detect infant mortality, which means that something stopped working immediately. Faulty batches, because for example there is one component that is broken. And the last stage is the after sales services. Here is where the product is already in the market. So there are two options. One is that the product is going to be used. We are going to manufacture it here in Tinas. Maybe there are some component issues that could be part of the guarantee, for example. And here, maybe those components has to be replaced or has to be fixed or something. Or maybe the product is still in use, but the components are getting obsolete, or they want the new characteristics in the component. So they do product variants. So this one will start again here. They would do they want a similar product with something new. So it starts again the cycle here. So the after sales service is the analysis repair and equipment updates. Okay, but that can be it disappears or there is an update and we have to start again the product. So there is product maintenance, customer technical assistance if something fails, and also it can be environmental management of electronic equipment because there are some rules to be followed. This equipment they cannot be wasted anyway. We have to follow some environmental rules. Okay, this was the last one.